Joe Biden isn't the man he was 20 years ago. He's older. He carried a heavy burden. Some days it really showed. But he's also wiser, more experienced, which is why he not only had the courage to pass the torch to Kamala, but the character to put America first. Donald Trump, on the other hand, is exactly who he was 20 years ago, a fraud, a criminal, a liar, a fool, a man who never kept a promise in business or to his family, a man without integrity, honor, or courage. Every day with Donald Trump is just more of the same. More lies, evasions, and attacks. He's just as selfish, small, petty, and full of hate and vengeance as he ever was. This election will be many things to many people, but the undeniable truth is that it's between a prosecutor and a criminal, between justice and corruption, between the hard truth and the big lie, between a candidate who wants to leave America a future and a criminal who can only cling to the past. The choice is still clear. It's America or Trump. It's Kamala or MAGA. It's us or them. Kamala Harris for president.
Winners never back down from a challenge. Champions know it's any time, any place. But losers, they whine and waffle and take their ball home.
Trump now refusing to debate a second time.
He did terribly in the last debate. He's so easily triggered by Kamala Harris.
Well, Donald, I do hope you'll reconsider to meet me on the debate stage. If you've got something to say,
say it to my face.
I'm Kamala Harris, and I approve this message.
But that's beside the point.
You got all kinds of stories for the barbershop.
Clear up the misinformation about your background on criminal justice.
I was probably one of the first elected prosecutors in the country to say we need to have reentry initiatives. And I designed from scratch and wrote out a program that focused in particular on young men who are arrested for drug sales. My policy was that we were not going to jail people for simple marijuana. And by the way, right now, I believe we need to just actually legalize the whole thing, and that's part of my platform.
Yes, for sure.
Shakur over here. Is a dean of students, and he works with our young people every day.
I'm from Philly, born and raised, uptown to be exact. I've been in education for 10 years. I started off as a teacher's assistant in a school in North Philly.
Only 1% of teachers in public schools are black men.
Yeah, for sure.
1%. The statistics are, if a black child has a black teacher by the end of third grade, they're like 13% more likely to go to college.
More likely to succeed, wow.
But to go to college, even.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, part of actually my focus and agenda is what we've got to do to create incentives,
mm-hmm.
which really are not necessarily incentives in terms of the will, but also we don't pay teachers enough.
Right.
Student loan debt is an mm-hmm. issue, you know, and yeah. thinking about how we create incentives to actually recruit and retain, because we know the benefit to
for
overall
sure.
society,
right.
And in particular to our children. You know, the beauty of human nature also is that when you set a high bar and you give people the chance to reach it, especially starting with our children, they will go for it every time.
Every mm-hmm. time.
Every single time. Every time. If you give a child from the beginning of their life all reinforcement that tells them they can be anything and do anything, and that they are loved and that they are special. I mean, that is one of the keys, I think, to what we can do for the children of our families, our community, right? I mean, I think about it, you know, I grew up at a time where, you know, Aretha was singing "You Are Young, Gifted, and Black."
Mm-hmm. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And every signal we received told us that.
Right.
Yeah.
And, you know, we weren't particularly special, but everybody told us we were.
Right.
And
right.
we believed them.
But what we were talking about is representation and why it matters.
That's right.
Being able to see yourself as a heroic figure.
Yeah, right.
Everybody feels lonely. Everybody
yeah,
feels like just
that's
things
true.
Aren't going your way. And
mm-hmm.
when you look around, the way that society is being constructed, the way that it's just everything is so against you. no matter who you are, you're going to have to hit the same roadblocks in life.
As a black man, you know, it was about 2 weeks ago you released your plan for black men. And first, let me say thank you for doing it.
I loved it.
But it's based on work I've been doing for years, by the way.
Exactly.
Right? Yeah.
But a lot of times brothers don't feel seen.
Yeah, but understandably.
And so literally having a plan that says, black men, this is for you, was extremely important. What we're seeing is getting more brothers to actually understand what's in the plan. But you also talked about other things. And I mean, I read the plan. Oh, I think
so.
It was
for example, to your point, I also know history to understand why people feel the way they do right now. And it's based on fact. You look at World War II. Okay. The people who went to fight that war, who were predominantly men, went to go fight that war. They came back and America called them the greatest generation. Because they did such an incredible job. And so many gave their lives for it. So the policy was, we should invest in the greatest generation. They've done so much for our country. And one of the things that we did as policy to create federal programs to help them, including giving an incredible infusion of resources into helping people buy homes, to become homeowners. But of course, we still had, at that time, incredible racism within the institutions. So in spite of a policy that was supposed to benefit everyone, which boosted a lot of people, our black servicemen did not benefit from that boost as much as others did. So you just look at these different moments in time, right? You look at redlining. I mean, it happened here in Philly. It happened all over the country, which is black people who were ready to buy homes in areas where they could then build the wealth, right, were not allowed to buy in those places. And today, black families are 40% less likely to own their homes than others, okay? So part of my plan and policy is recognizing that, to give people a $25,000 down payment assistance if they're a first-time home buyer, which just helps people literally get their foot in the door. And then folks will save up. They'll do what they do to make the mortgage. Part of my plan is a $6,000 child tax credit for the first year of your child's life. Because as we know, the vast majority of our parents, young fathers and mothers, want to parent their children well, but don't always have the resources to do it. Part of my plan is about dealing with black men's health. I mean, we know the statistics. First of all, black people are 60% more likely to be diagnosed with diabetes. When we talk about our men, like twice as likely to die from things like colon cancer and prostate cancer.
I lost my wife last month to colon cancer.
I know you did.
So
I
when you talk about colon cancer.
I know you did. And I'm so sorry.
I appreciate that. But the truth is,
I lost my mother to colon cancer.
You're so right. We have to utilize our platforms to make sure that people understand early screening, early detection, and for brothers, like we'll come in the barbershop, we'll talk about everything else, but we won't talk about healthcare. We won't talk about those things that could mean life or death.
That's exactly right. And so, the quality of life too.
Yes.
Right? I know and see and understand the dimensions of life that we are talking about when we talk about our men. And it's about home ownership. It's about being a business person. It's about having dreams. It's about having ambitions. It's about education. It's about health. And it's, yes, it is about the election, but it's more than that. Because part to the point that we've been talking about and you talked about so beautifully, people, when people feel alone, it's very disempowering. Right? When you feel it's like you against the world, it's very disempowering. And I want people to know that they are not alone.
I tell people all the time, there's going to be a president, there's going to be members of Congress.
Right.
There are going to be governors, there are going to be members of the General Assembly, there are going to be mayors and city council. The question that we have to ask ourselves as black men, are we going to have a say in who those people are going to be?
That's exactly right.
And when you don't vote, those folks still get elected, you just don't get to decide.
That's exactly right. So I wrote with Cory Booker the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act when I was in the Senate. And there were a bunch of folks who did not want it to happen and worked against it. And we still need to pass the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act, okay? But they worked against it. And then those are the same people who will quietly suggest see, you shouldn't vote because nothing happens when you do. Mm-hmm. Because there are forces that also trying to obstruct the good work. And here's the thing, though. If you don't vote, then you're not deciding who's in the positions of power to make decisions like, do we pass the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act? You see the vicious cycle?
Right. Yeah.
So you don't vote, and then you end up taking yourself out of the game. And we should never take ourselves out of the game.
There's a national spotlight every 4 years around the big ticket, the presidential election and everything like that. Mm-hmm. There's also very important to make sure that you're voting in your local elections also.
Good.
Your judges, your state reps, your city council people, and also being engaged in that process so that you understand how all of these different functions work together.
Right. To get the word out, whether people vote for me or not, whether they vote or not. Well, although we want to encourage them to vote for me.
Everybody's
voting. But let's get the word out so people also understand what they have a right to expect and demand. Because this is not about doing anybody a favor. It's literally the right thing to do. Mm-hmm. Period.
Well, you survived. You survived the barbershop.
I had no question about that. Were you worried?
I know. I mean, I knew you was going to.
I think you were worried.
No, I wasn't.
Are you all right?
You were okay. Harris. You were Harris. That's how we built. Let's thank the vice president for hanging out with us a little bit.
Thank you for letting me come into the barbershop. I know what a sacred space this is. Yeah. I mean, it's so funny. I was going to say, but this is where America's news gets told.
No, for sure.
Right? Like all the press were here. This is where America's news gets told.
It is now official then, Kriti.
It's official. Happened with the virtual roll call just in the last 24 hours. I think the kind of parade and the pomp that we were expecting out of this is quite limited. And I think that really tells you about this idea that it was kind of a foregone conclusion that Kamala Harris was not only going to clinch the nomination, but she was going to be the first black woman and the first South Asian woman to do it.
Kamala Harris, let's have a good debate.
Nice to see you. Have fun.
Thank you.
Welcome to you both. It's wonderful to have you. It's an honor to have you both here tonight. Why do you believe it's appropriate to weigh in on the racial identity of your opponent?
I don't, and I don't care. I don't care what she is. I don't care. You make a big deal out of something. I couldn't care less. Whatever she wants to be is okay with me.
But those were your words, so I'm
asking. I don't know. I mean, all I can say is I read where she was not black, that she put out, and I'll say that, and then I read that she was black, and that's okay. Either one was okay with me. That's up to her.
I mean, honestly, I think it's a tragedy that we have someone who wants to be president who has consistently, over the course of his career, attempted to use race to divide the American people. You know, I do believe that the vast majority of us know that we have so much more in common than what separates us, and we don't want this kind of approach that is just constantly trying to divide us, and especially by race.
Everything that she believed 3 years ago and 4 years ago is out the window. She's going to my philosophy now. In fact, I was going to send her a MAGA hat. She's gone to my philosophy. But if she ever got elected, she'd change it. And it will be the end of our country. She's a Marxist. Everybody knows she's a Marxist. Her father's a Marxist professor in economics, and he taught her well. She gave up at least 12 and probably 14 or 15 different policies. Like, she was big on defund the police. In Minnesota, she went out. Wait a minute, I'm talking now, if you don't mind, please. Does that sound familiar? They have abortion in the ninth month. They even have, and you can look at the governor of West Virginia, the previous governor of West Virginia, not the current governor, who's doing an excellent job, but the governor before. He said, the baby will be born, and we will decide what to do with the baby. In other words, we'll execute the baby.
There is no state in this country where it is legal to kill a baby after it's born.
Donald Trump hand-selected three members of the United States Supreme Court with the intention that they would undo the protections of Roe v. Wade. And they did exactly as he intended. And now in over 20 states, there are Trump abortion bans, which make it criminal for a doctor or nurse to provide health care. In one state, it provides prison for life. Trump abortion bans that make no exception even for rape and incest, which understand what that means. A survivor of a crime, a violation to their body, does not have the right to make a decision about what happens to their body next. That is immoral. And I pledge to you, when Congress passes a bill to put back in place the protections of Roe v. Wade. As President of the United States, I will proudly sign it into law. But understand, if Donald Trump were to be reelected, he will sign a national abortion ban.
It's a lie. I'm not signing a ban, and there's no reason to sign a ban, because we've gotten what everybody wanted, Democrats, Republicans, and everybody else, and every legal scholar wanted it to be brought back into the states, and the states are voting, and it may take a little time, but for 52 years, this issue has torn our country apart, and they've wanted it back in the states, and I did something that nobody thought was possible. The states are now voting. What she says is an absolute lie. And as far as the abortion ban, no, I'm not in favor of abortion ban, but it doesn't matter because this issue has now been taken over by the states.
Would you support any restrictions on a woman's right to an abortion?
I absolutely support reinstating the protections of Roe v. Wade. And as you rightly mentioned, nowhere in America is a woman carrying a pregnancy to term and asking for an abortion. That is not happening. It's insulting to the women of America.
What we will do is we're looking at different plans. If we can come up with a plan that's going to cost our people, our population, less money and be better health care than Obamacare, then I would absolutely do it. But until then, I'd run it as good as it can be run.
So just a yes or no, you still do not have a plan?
I have concepts of a plan. I'm not president right now. But if we come up with something, I would only change it if we come up with something that's better and less expensive. And there are concepts and options we have to do that. And you'll be hearing about it in the not too distant future.
I'm going to actually do something really unusual. And I'm going to invite you to attend one of Donald Trump's rallies because it's a really interesting thing to watch. You will see during the course of his rallies, he talks about fictional characters like Hannibal Lecter. He will talk about windmills cause cancer. And what you will also notice is that people start leaving his rallies early out of exhaustion and boredom. And I will tell you, the one thing you will not hear him talk about is you. You will not hear him talk about your needs, your dreams, and your desires. And I'll tell you, I believe you deserve a president who actually puts you first, and I pledge to you that I will.
We have the biggest rallies, the most incredible rallies in the history of politics. That's because people want to take their country back. Our country is being lost. We're a failing nation. In Springfield, they're eating the dogs, the people that came in. They're eating the cats. They're eating the pets of the people that live there. And this is what's happening in our country, and it's a shame.
I just want to clarify here. You bring up Springfield, Ohio, and ABC News did reach out to the city manager there. He told us there have been no credible reports of specific claims of pets being harmed, injured, or abused by individuals within the immigrant community.
Crime here is up and through the roof. Despite their fraudulent statements that they made, crime in this country is through the roof. And we have a new form of crime. It's called migrant crime. And it's happening at levels that nobody thought possible.
President Trump, as you know, the FBI says overall violent crime is actually coming down in this country.
Well, I think this is so rich coming from someone who has been prosecuted for national security crimes, economic crimes, election interference, has been found liable for sexual assault, and his next big court appearance is in November at his own criminal sentencing. Understand, this is someone who has openly said he would terminate, I'm quoting, terminate the Constitution of the United States, that he would weaponize the Department of Justice against his political enemies.
This is the one that weaponized, not me. She weaponized. I probably took a bullet to the head because of the things that they say about me. They talk about democracy. I'm a threat to democracy. They're the threat to democracy.
In the past couple of weeks leading up to this debate, you have said, quote, you lost by a whisker, that you, quote, didn't quite make it, that you came up a little bit short.
I said that?
Are you now acknowledging that you lost in 2020?
No, I don't acknowledge that at all.
But
I said that sarcastically.
That.
You know that. It was said, oh, we lost by a whisker. That was said sarcastically.
Vice President Harris, you heard the president there tonight. He said he didn't say that he lost by a whisker. So he still believes he did not lose the election that was won by President Biden and yourself. But I do want to ask you about something that's come up in the last couple of days. This was a post from President Trump about this upcoming election just weeks away. He said, when I win, those people who cheated, and then he lists donors, voters, election officials, he says, will be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law, which will include long-term prison sentences. One of your campaign's top lawyers responded saying, we won't let Donald Trump intimidate us. We won't let him suppress the vote. Is that what you believe he's trying to do here?
Donald Trump was fired by 81 million people. So let's be clear about that. And clearly he is having a very difficult time processing that. We have to know that sometimes people will open the door for you and leave it open. Sometimes they won't. And then you need to kick that door down. Excuse my language.
Auntie is getting ready to go to, you can be with her, baby. You gonna be with her? Come on. Go on to the polling site. She's not gonna be denied. Y'all, don't y'all pay me no attention. That's right, that's right. She said she got this. That is so wonderful. Take your time. Take your time. Put your stuff up. Let me put my sticker on. I earned that. Go on, Auntie. I'm so proud of y'all together. So we're going to North Carolina, we're going to treat them to lunch. We're going to have fried catfish, hush puppies, and okra, and cake. Carolyn made a turtle cake, and we're going to have nice desserts, and these two young ladies voted today. All right, Kamala is so proud of you. And you walked to the polls. You strolled to the polls and voted. You did that. Praise on. That's our Auntie Verlene Baskin, matriarch of the family, voted in the 2024 presidential election. She made sure her voice was heard. Praise on.
This is an ABC News special report. Now reporting, David Muir.
Good afternoon. We're coming on the air. We want to take you to live pictures right now because Vice President Kamala Harris is about to come before the cameras at her alma mater, Howard University in Washington, D.C., to concede her loss to former President Donald Trump. The Vice President, of course, hoped to give a different speech last night, but here she is today after learning that she has lost the election to the former president. She's at her alma mater in Washington, D.C., where so many supporters had gathered last night hoping that they would hear a much different speech from the vice president. Today, delivering this speech.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Thank you all. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So let me say, and I love you back. And I love you back. So let me say, my heart is full today. My heart is full today. Full of gratitude for the trust you have placed in me. Full of love for our country. And full of resolve. The outcome of this election is not what we wanted, not what we fought for, not what we voted for. But hear me when I say, hear me when I say, the light of America's promise will always burn bright. As we never give up, and as long as we keep fighting. Yeah! To my beloved Doug and our family, I love you so very much. To President Biden and Dr. Biden, thank you for your faith and support. To Governor Walz and the Walz family, I know your service to our nation will continue. And to my extraordinary team, to the volunteers who gave so much of themselves, to the poll workers and the local election officials, I thank you. I thank you all. Look, I am so proud of the race we ran and the way we ran it. And the way we ran it. Over the 107 days of this campaign, we have been intentional about building community and building coalitions, bringing people together from every walk of life and background, united by love of country, with enthusiasm and joy in our fight for America's future. And we did it with the knowledge that we all have so much more in common than what separates us. Now, I know folks are feeling and experiencing a range of emotions right now. I get it. But we must accept the results of this election. Earlier today, I spoke with President-elect Trump and congratulated him on his victory. I also told him that we will help him and his team with their transition, and that we will engage in a peaceful transfer of power.
A fundamental principle of American democracy is that when we lose an election, we accept the results. That principle, as much as any other, distinguishes democracy from monarchy or tyranny. And anyone who seeks the public trust must honor it. At the same time, in our nation, we owe loyalty not to a president or a party, but to the Constitution of the United States. And loyalty to our conscience and to our God. My allegiance to all three is why I am here to say, while I concede this election, I do not concede the fight that fueled this campaign. The fight for freedom, for opportunity, for fairness, and the dignity of all people. A fight for the ideals at the heart of our nation, the ideals that reflect America at our best. That is a fight I will never give up. I will never give up the fight for a future where Americans can pursue their dreams, ambitions, and aspirations, where the women of America have the freedom to make decisions about their own body and not have their government telling them what to do. We will never give up the fight to protect our schools and our streets from gun violence. And America, we will never give up the fight for our democracy, for the rule of law, for equal justice, and for the sacred idea that every one of us, no matter who we are or where we start out, has certain fundamental rights and freedoms that must be respected and upheld. And we will continue to wage this fight in the voting booth, in the courts, and in the public square. And we will also wage it in quieter ways, in how we live our lives, by treating one another with kindness and respect, by looking in the face of a stranger and seeing a neighbor, by always using our strength to lift people up, to fight for the dignity that all people deserve. The fight for our freedom will take hard work, but like I always say, we like hard work. Hard work is good work. Hard work can be joyful work. And the fight for our country is always worth it. It is always worth it. To the young people who are watching, it is... I love you. To the young people who are watching, it is okay to feel sad and disappointed. But please know it's going to be okay. On the campaign, I would often say, when we fight, we win. But here's the thing. Sometimes the fight takes a while. That doesn't mean we won't win. The important thing is don't ever give up. Don't ever stop trying to make the world a better place. You have power. You have power. And don't you ever listen when anyone tells you something is impossible because it has never been done before. You have the capacity to do extraordinary good in the world. And so to everyone who is watching, do not despair. This is not a time to throw up our hands. This is a time to roll up our sleeves. This is a time to organize, to mobilize, and to stay engaged for the sake of freedom and justice and the future that we all know we can build together. Look, many of you know I started out as a prosecutor, and throughout my career, I saw people at some of the worst times in their lives, people who had suffered great harm and great pain, and yet found within themselves the strength and the courage and the resolve to take the stand, to take a stand, to fight for justice, to fight for themselves, to fight for others. So let their courage be our inspiration. Let their determination be our charge. And I'll close with this. There's an adage an historian once called a law of history, true of every society across the ages. The adage is, only when it is dark enough can you see the stars. I know many people feel like we are entering a dark time, but for the benefit of us all, I hope that is not the case. But here's the thing, America, if it is, let us fill the sky with the light of a brilliant, brilliant billion of stars. The light of optimism, of faith, of truth, and service. H.U. And may that work guide us, even in the face of setbacks, toward the extraordinary promise of the United States of America. I thank you all. May God bless you, and may God bless the United States of America. I thank you all.
Vice President Kamala Harris at Howard University, likely the most difficult speech of her career, saying, "My heart is full, full of gratitude, full of love for our country, full of resolve." She said the outcome of the election is not what we fought for, but she said the light of America's promise will always burn bright as long as we never give up fighting. She talked about reaching out to President-elect Donald Trump today. She said we will help his team. We will engage in a peaceful transfer of power to applause there in the crowd. She talked about her loyalty to the Constitution and her expectation that that same loyalty will be shared by the President-elect. And she added there, "While I concede this election, I do not concede the fight that fueled this campaign, the fight for freedom, for opportunity, for fairness, and for the dignity of all people."